I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. He has made me glad, for he has made me glad. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. This is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad.
He has made me glad, oh, he has made me glad. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad.
He has made me glad,
oh, he has made me glad.
I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad.
Hallelujah!
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 Good morning. Yeah, I'm back from vacation. It's nice to see you all here this morning. It's great to be here this morning. I'm going to wear my hoodie today. I realized that this would be a perfect excuse to wear a robe, but I was reading something that Pope Francis had recently wrote or said. I think it was his Christmas address, and he was saying that we needed more saints in sneakers and jeans as opposed to those wearing flowing robes. And I was thinking, well, sneakers and jeans, I mean, shorts and flip-flops, that's more me. But this morning, it's not shorts and flip-flops weather, but the hoodie is quite appropriate, as it's just a little chilly here in the Sunshine State, minus the sunshine. Few guests here, there are a few visitors here this morning. Would you like to identify yourselves? Raise your hand. As being a first-time visitor, we got one, Larry, up here. Raise your hand again. There he sees you now. Charlie's bringing you over a folder. This is who we are and what we do here at King of Kings. Any other first-time visitors? Okay. Still looking for readers and ushers. The more people that we can involve in the actual worship service itself, the better off. So if you're interested in reading or ushering or helping to be a communion assistant, let Charlie know. We're also looking for more people to help with the Church Altar Guild. That's the person who makes sure that we have our elements up there, that we have the proper color vestments on the altar there as well. So if you have, if you're called to serve in a way, see Chris. Chris, raise your hand, wave your hand. There you go. Thank you. Any other weekly announcements, I invite you to look at your insert. But this week, on Friday, there's a country music dance at 5, and on Saturday, at 1 o'clock, there will be the music jam. Next Sunday, right after worship, get yourself a treat and come back, is our annual congregational meeting. This is an important time in our congregation where we approve their budget, we elect the council members for that coming year, and we basically get caught up with all the things that have gone on this past year. So please make a point of staying after. If the council meeting goes well, we should be done in less than 20 minutes.
We have an announcement in the back.
We have. I haven't asked for them yet. Oh, you, Chris, is it due with the congregational meeting? Okay, I can continue. You sure? Okay. Another very important announcement. Mark your calendars. Saturday, February 24th, next month, we will be having a retreat, a congregational retreat. This is a very important event in the life of the congregation, in the aspect of being a congregation in transition. This establishes what the core value of the congregation, the vision for this congregation is. This is a very important part of the interim process. So that retreat will take place from 10 to 2. You'll get regular announcements about that. And I encourage all of you, a couple weeks will be a sign-up sheet. I encourage all members of the congregation to set aside Saturday, February 24th from 10 to 2. Now, are there any other announcements for the good of family? Yes, Chris.
I apologize, Pastor. I just want to let everyone know that those that do attend the quilting on Monday, we're changing it to be a Tuesday going forward.
Okay.
And also there'll be a sheet going down for our covered dish next week. Thank you.
After the congregational meeting.
Yes.
Okay. Any other announcements for the good of the family? Yes.
Merry Widow Luncheon tomorrow.
Merry Widow Luncheon tomorrow. Where and when? Beef O'Brady.
At 12.
At 12. Which Beef O'Brady?
Ridge and
the one at Hobby Lobby?
And Little.
Ridge and Little.
Yeah.
Okay. Beef O'Brady, Ridge and Little. 1 o'clock? 12 o'clock, 12 o'clock, 12 o'clock, Ridge and Little, Beef O'Brady, Merry Widows. Okay? Any other announcements? I saw a couple children. You want to help me with a message here? You're not too old yet, Kyla. You're getting there, not quite yet. Okay. Can you tell me what season this is? Winter, yeah, that's a good general one. How about within the church? We had the season of Advent, and then we had the season of Christmas. And now we're in the season of Epiphany. Epiphany. What is an epiphany? I heard it over here. It's an aha moment. It's a sudden realization. It's having a bit of information opened up to you that oft times can make a big difference in your life. Now, why do you think we call it epiphany? Well, here's a question that we're going to ask. Who is Jesus to us as a congregation, to us as a big community, or more importantly, and this is the most important question, we can always ask ourselves, who is Jesus to you? A loving, caring person, that's a good answer. But there's more than that, isn't there? Savior, teacher, big brother, advocate. Jesus can be so many different things. And, excuse me, this season of Epiphany is when we are invited to think about that, to learn about that, to pray about that, okay? So that's what this whole season that comes after Christmas but before Lent is about, learning about who Jesus is to us, okay? Sounds pretty cool, doesn't it? Let's pray. Dear Lord, in this season of Epiphany, help us to grow in our understanding of you and in our relationship with you. Let us discover something new this season about you and about us and about what we can do together. We pray all this because it's important. We pray all this in your name and let the people say, amen. Okay, you know the drill, help yourself. Then invite those of you who are able to stand as we begin our worship service. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, creator of darkness and light, word of truth, wind sweeping over waters.
Amen.
Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. God, our rock and our refuge, we pour our hearts out before you. We have known you, but have not always loved you. We have wounded one another and sinned against you. We have not always recognized the Holy Spirit dwelling in each of us. Remember your covenant, renew our creation, restore us that we might proclaim your good news to all. Amen. The voice of the Lord is upon the waters. God has spoken. The time of grace is now. In Jesus, the reign of God has come near. By the authority of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. You are God's beloved.
Amen. Amen.
Thank you. the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Please join me in praying the prayer of the day.
Thanks be to you, Lord Jesus Christ, most merciful Redeemer, for the countless blessings and benefits you give. May we know you more clearly, love you more dearly, and follow you more nearly, day by day praising you, with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Please be seated.
Our first reading is from Samuel 1. Now the boy Samuel was ministering to the Lord under Eli. The word of the Lord was rare in those days. Visions were not widespread. At that time, Eli, whose eyesight had begun to grow dim, so he could not see, was lying down in his room. The lamp of God had not yet gone out, and Samuel was lying down in the temple of the Lord, where the ark of God was. Then the Lord called, "Samuel, Samuel." And he said, "Here I am," and ran to Eli and said, "Here I am, for you called me." But he said, "I did not call you. Lie down again." So he went and lied down. The Lord called again, "Samuel, Samuel." Got up and went to Eli and said, "Here I am, for you called me." But he said, "I did not call, my son. Lie down again." Now Samuel did not know the Lord, and the word of the Lord had not been revealed to him. The Lord called Samuel again, a third time, and he got up and went to Eli and said, "Here I am, for you called me." Then Eli perceived that the Lord was calling the boy. Therefore Eli said to Samuel, "Go, lie down, and if he calls you, you shall speak, and say, 'Speak, Lord, for you, your servant is listening.'" So Samuel went and laid down in his place. Now the Lord came and stood there, calling as before, "Samuel, Samuel." And Samuel said, "Speak, for your servant is listening." Then the Lord said to Samuel, "See, I am about to do something in Israel that will make both ears of everyone hears of its tingle. On that day, I will fulfill against Eli all that I have spoken concerning his house from beginning to end. For I have told him that I am about to punish his house forever for the iniquity that he knew, because his sons were blaspheming God, and he did not restrain them. Therefore, I swear to the house of Eli that the iniquity of Eli's house shall not be explained by sacrifice or for offering forever." Samuel lay there until morning. Then he went, opened the doors of the house of the Lord. Samuel was afraid to tell the vision of Eli to Eli. But Eli called Samuel and said, "Samuel, my son." He said, "Here I am." Eli said, "What was it that he told you? Do not hide it from me. May God do so to you and more also, if you hide anything from me of all that he told you." So Samuel told him everything, he hid nothing from him. Then he said, "It is the Lord. Let him do what seems good to him." As Samuel grew up, the Lord was with him and let none of his words fall to the ground. And all Israel, from Dan to Beersheba, knew that Samuel was a trustworthy prophet of the Lord. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our second reading is from Psalms. "Lord, you have searched me out. You know my sitting down and my rising up.
You discern my thoughts from afar.
You trace my journeys and my resting places,
and are acquainted with all my ways.
Indeed, this is not a word of my lips,
but you, O Lord, know it altogether.
You encompass me behind and before,
and lay your hand upon me.
Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. For you yourself created my inmost parts.
You knit me together in my mother's womb.
I will thank you because I am marvelously made.
Your works are wonderful, and I know it well.
My body was not hidden from you.
While I was being made in secret and woven in the depths of the earth.
Your eyes beheld my limbs, yet unfinished in the womb, all of them were written in your book.
My days were fashioned.
How deep I find your thoughts, O God.
How great is the sum of them.
If I were to count them, they would be more in number than the sand.
To count them all, I stand with you to be like yours.
Okay, second reading is from Corinthians. All things are lawful for me, but not all things are beneficial. All things are lawful for me, but I will not be dominated by anything. Food is meant for the stomach, and the stomach for food. And the God will destroy both one and another. The body is meant not for fornication, but for the Lord, and the Lord for the body. And God raised the Lord and will also raise us by his power. Do not know that the bodies are members of Christ? Should I therefore take the members of Christ and make them members of a prostitute? Never. Do you not know that whoever is united to a prostitute becomes one body with her? For it is said, the two shall be one flesh. But anyone united to the Lord becomes one spirit with him. Shun fornication. Every sin that a person commits is outside the body, but the fornicator sins against the body itself. Or do you know that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit within you, which you have from God, and that you are not your own? For you were bought with a price, therefore glorify God in your body. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel according to John, the first chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
The next day, Jesus decided to go to Galilee. He found Philip and said to him, "Follow me." Now, Philip was from Bethsaida, the city of Andrew and Peter. Philip found Nathanael and said to him, "We have found him about whom Moses in the law and also the prophets wrote. Jesus, son of Joseph, from Nazareth." Nathanael said to him, "Can anything good come out of Nazareth?" Philip said to him, "Come and see." When Jesus saw Nathanael coming toward him, he said to him, "Here is truly an Israelite in whom there is no deceit." Nathanael asked him, "Where did you get to know me?" Jesus answered, "I saw you under the fig tree before Philip called you." Nathanael replied, "Rabbi, you are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel." Jesus answered, "Do you believe because I told you that I saw you under the fig tree? You will see greater things than these." And he said to him, "Very truly I tell you, you will see heaven opened and the angels of God ascending and descending upon the Son of Man." The Gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Please be seated. One, two, three. You may be an ambassador to England or France. You may like to gamble. You may like to dance. You may be the heavyweight champion of the world. You may be a socialite with a long string of pearls, but you're gonna have to serve somebody. Oh, yes, you are. You're gonna have to serve somebody. Well, it may be the devil, or it may be the Lord, but you're gonna have to serve somebody. Last week, I thought I knew what the gospel lesson was because I knew the week before it was the baptism of Jesus. And coming right after that, in the Gospels of Luke and Matthew, and we are in the year of Matthew, is the Jesus being sent into the wilderness to the temptations. Well, sometimes you get a little bit off. And when I got the lessons this week and I'm reading through them, well, those aren't the lessons I thought it was going to be. And I start reading through, I love the story of the call of Samuel, and I like the story with Nathanael. I usually avoid Paul because, well, I find Paul, as much as he says some really great things, he's hard to preach from because it's like, here's the point, it's already argued out. It's hard to expand on. So I'm reading the Old Testament lesson, I'm reading the gospel, and nothing, well, little things are coming here and there, but nothing's really coming together. So, I think it was about Wednesday morning. I got up in the morning, I said, maybe I got to read Paul. Well, I'm reading that lesson from Corinthians. Now, I find Paul sometimes, quite often, a little priggish. And I'm reading that lesson from Corinthians. And I start here, you got to serve somebody. Oh, yes, you are. You're going to have to serve somebody. Now, I didn't know this song other than that one line. I mean, I don't remember it in per se. I don't have any albums with it on, but I did remember that chorus, and it just kept coming to me. So I did the next best thing. I fed that line, "You're going to have to serve somebody," into my Google, and it came up with this song. It's a song by Bob Dylan, if you didn't know that. It was written and produced and put on an album in 1979. And as I'm reading it, I'm realizing this is kind of Paul's point through a lot of his lessons, that you've already been paid for, and we have to recognize who we serve. And in fact, when you go through the authentic letters from Paul, the six that the 90% of all biblical scholars agree that these are genuine Pauline epistles. The very last one he wrote, the letter to the Romans, which we see first because it's the longest one. That's how they put them in order, the longest to the shortest. He starts out, Paul, a servant of the Lord Jesus Christ. In that Old Testament reading, when Eli has finally figured out what's happening with Samuel, he tells him to respond, "Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening." Now, I recognize that the idea of being a servant in this culture, in this country, is repulsive, off-putting, but it holds true. We are going to serve somebody. And Bob Dylan takes it right down to its essence. It's going to be the devil or it's going to be the Lord. You may be a construction worker working on a home. You may live in a mansion. You may be living in a dome. You may own guns. You might even own tanks. Maybe somebody's landlord. You might even own banks. But you're going to have to serve somebody. Oh, yes, you are. You're going to have to serve somebody. Well, it may be the devil or it may be the Lord, but you're going to have to serve somebody. Bob Dylan wrote this as part of his metamorphosis in becoming a Christian. And he said he had come to the conclusion that the only way we truly find happiness and fulfillment is by being faithful and serving the Lord. Now, some of his peers didn't react so well to his statement about this. They thought he was getting a little too out there in his music. In fact, John Lennon, in response to Bob Dylan write, "You Gotta Serve Somebody," wrote a song called "Serve Yourself." Now, that gives an interesting perspective between the two parallels, the two poles of serving the devil or the Lord. Well, you can serve yourself. But the problem is, you might have great ideals. You might have a code or an ideology that you can fight that's very pure. But we are human. And as human, we are prone to breaking. We are human, and we don't go through life without getting some wounds, getting some hurts, instilling some anger. And all these negative emotions, all this pain of life, quite often turns us away from that high ideal that we think we serve, and it starts to corrupt us. And ultimately, if you're not serving God, you're serving the devil. You may be a preacher for your spiritual pride. You may be a city councilman taking bribes on the side. You may be working in a barber shop because you know how to cut hair. You may be somebody's mistress. You may be somebody's heir, but you're going to have to serve somebody. Yes, you are. You're going to have to serve somebody. Well, it may be the devil or it may be the Lord, but you're going to have to serve somebody. In the Old Testament lesson this morning, the church, the religious institution of the day, was being led by the house of Eli. Now, Eli might have started out as a good and faithful servant of God, but his sons, as it's made very clear in the book of Samuel, were not. His sons decided that they were going to use the power to serve themselves. And Eli was not doing anything about it. Eli, like many of us, chose to avoid confrontation. How many of us choose to avoid confrontation when people start speaking off with racist, bigoted language? We'll just sort of quietly walk away rather than confronting it. When people start spouting off anti-theology about condemnation and damnation of certain groups of people, rather than confronting and pointing out that from what we understand, God loves and cares for all of creation, we choose to just not confront. So the church of the day, the holy center of the day, had been corrupted. And when God calls Samuel, he tells Samuel what's going to befall the sons of Eli, what's going to befall the house of Eli. Eli accepts it. Yeah, you're probably right. That's what's going to happen. And the church and other institutions of power are no less susceptible to that corruption today. We forget quite often who we're supposed to serve, and we start to serve ourselves or some sort of idealized vision that has nothing to do with the calling of Jesus Christ. Now, how do we, as puny, vulnerable, broken humans, keep our focus on where God, where Christ is calling us in our lives? Well, daily prayer, daily scripture reading, spending an inordinate amount of time reading not just the words out of the Bible, but reading all those people that happened both before and after the advent of Christ, all those spiritual giants, how they have broken down the word to relate to their time and their culture and their situation, so that you can start hearing the word to relate to your time, your culture, and your situation. Well, yeah, we can all go and spend 3 to 4 years of our life in seminary, because that's basically what you're doing there. Or you can just go look for that group of people who is undeserved, unserved. That group of people that has no power, that's being discriminated against, that has no voice, they're being quieted. Those people who are the least among us, the homeless, the addictive, the riffraff, the flotsam and jetsam of our society, and you can serve them. Because I can guarantee you this, and every spiritual giant before me has said the same thing, so I'm not saying anything new. Any place that you find a line where we have drawn between the having and deserving and the have not and undeserving, Jesus is going to be on the other side of that line with that group of the least of these. So if you want to encounter Christ, you seek out the least among us and you endeavor to serve them. Now that doesn't mean that you don't pray, because you're probably going to be led to more prayer, and that doesn't mean that you don't read the Bible. You're probably going to want to read the Bible more, because you're going to be asking those big questions. Why God? And then people will start to ask you, well, why have you kind of turned your back on fame and fortune, turned your back on riches and security, and instead seem to be so comfortable with it? And all you can say then, well, come and see. Come and see what it means to live in that relationship with a God who's forgiven us for our humanity, for all the times we've broken. Come and see what it is to discover the gifts that you've been given that maybe you've never exercised in your life. Come and see what it means to wake up every morning and go to sleep every night, knowing that the God of all, the most powerful being in all of creation, not only loves you with all their heart and soul, but desires to be in a relationship with you each day. Amen.
In Christ you have heard the word of faith, the gospel of salvation.
We believe in him and our heart is the seal of the promised Holy Spirit.
Sorry, we're all gathering there. Living together in trust and hope, we confess our faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended to heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated. Those wonderful prayers that are printed in your bulletins, I again invite you to take those home. They are good prayers that you can read out and meditate over. But I really still believe that the prayers of the church need to come from the people assembled on that morning as we lift up those things that we are both happy and joyful about, where God has been present in our lives, but also then those things that we are praying on, and we want to invite the rest of the congregation, those assembled, to pray with us. So we have any joys that we'd like to share? Does anybody have a joy? Yeah, right here we got one.
Joni Maggio, sitting next to me here, is about to become a member of this church, and I just want to celebrate her birthday this week. It's on Wednesday. Her name didn't show up because she's not a member, but I thought we might all sing happy birthday to Joni.
Oh, yes. It's a wonderful thing. You ready? Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Joni. Happy birthday to you. Amen. Other joys. Oh, we got some hands there.
I have a great joy. My granddaughter drove all the way down from New York to visit.
And you left the snow behind. Yay! In the back there.
Roger and I have a great joy. Our house is finally finished enough that we emptied the two pods yesterday. And
hey!
We're still at the hotel for a day or two, but hopefully within this week we'll be a little bit settled. Now we just have a bunch of boxes to unpack.
Amen. That's a wonderful. How many months has it been? 5 months. Hotel rooms get small, folks, let me tell you.
I yesterday I got a home. So I'm happy. I got a room. I'm renting out a room, and it's right next to Barbara's house. So God works in mysterious ways,
Ollie's.
And I'm very happy.
Amen. Other joys.
I just wanted to say thank you for all your thoughts and prayers for these last 5.5 months. And I also wanted to say thanks, but no thanks, to the people that asked us to move in with them August 30th. Aren't you glad I said no?
Any other joys? Okay, how about some concerns? Are there things that we're praying for up here?
I think probably everybody here knows who Don Payton is. Don is the band leader for the first and the second Friday dances. He also does a lot with our jams. He's attorney to a lot of us. But I heard a rumor yesterday that Don had a stroke. And so we did a little research and we found out I tried to call, nobody could get a hold of him, but Charlie was smart enough to call Jimmy, who is Don's partner in the band. And we got the final answer, and he didn't have a stroke, thank God. He had a ruptured vein in the rectum, and he was almost bleeding to death. He wound up in the hospital, and they got that taken care of somewhat, but then they put him into rehab, and then he had a relapse on that, and he's back in the hospital. But I know an awful lot of people here are going to be thinking real heavily about praying for Don and for his wife, Brenda. Thank you.
I'm going to lift up Don and Brenda. Yeah, in the back there. She'll get to you.
Hi, I want to pray for everyone to pray for a friend of mine who developed COVID and stopped breathing, had to go on a ventilator for 4 weeks, and is now in rehab. Praise God. So if you will, just keep Richard in your prayers.
Okay.
Yeah, my neighbor and good friend of mine, Joe DeLutra, is in the hospital with intestinal problems. So they may operate on him, so keep him in your prayers.
Amen. Amen. I have one I'd like to share. I've shared with a number of you already. A good friend, one-time mentor. I was planning to visit on our trip north. He lived in North Carolina, and when I went to try to contact him the day after Christmas, I found out he had died. And he was 87 years old. He died last May. But when you find out the grief, I don't know if anybody's ever been through this, where you find out somebody has passed months after they've actually passed. The grief is odd, and I've been dealing with this grief. He was a very important person in my life. He taught me a lot, not just about construction and how to manage a construction site, but about how managing people and life in general. And he became a very good friend, and I'm very thankful that the last time I saw him, which was in August of 2022, we sat up late into the evening, and I took the time to tell him how important he was to me and how much our relationship meant to me. And just as a reminder, when you have those people in your life, don't hold back telling them, because sometimes they can be gone in a twinkling of an eye, and you're just left with the sadness that this person's there. So I want to lift up John Bischoff's family. He has 5 daughters. I've only ever met a couple of them briefly, our relationship was more one-on-one. So I've been trying to contact them just to spend all my condolences, and I just haven't had any luck yet. So thank you. Any other concerns that we're lifting up here today? Yes, up there.
I just wanted some prayers for
my brother-in-law, Suzette's husband, Herb Bombo. He's in the hospital now with congestive heart failure.
Okay. Thank you, Doris. Any others? You got one in the back there. See, that's why I'm glad you're young.
If you could keep my Aunt Barbara in your prayers, she is close to passing. She has a brain tumor. She's in the hospital. They're looking at bringing her home, if she makes it that long, early next week. Her daughters have lost their father already, so also keep them in prayer as they will have to learn how to manage life on their own.
Amen. Anyone else? Yeah, we got to go right here.
Charlie, would you help me out a little bit and tell us what the situation with Marianne is? Yeah. She's still in the hospital. Okay. Well, is there anything to the rumor I heard that they were putting her in hospice? Okay, but it hasn't been official. Okay. Anyway, you know, I just couldn't help it. I couldn't let that pass that we didn't mention her. She's been a big part of, not the church so much, but the activities over in the hall. The pantry and the jams and the dances and everything.
Amen. And one more up here.
I lost a nephew, 56 years old, who has had health problems as far back as a very young child. Hasn't had a very good life, health-wise. He just died recently, this past week, and my feeling was it was victory, finally. We thought maybe he would die a lot sooner because of this health problem. But he is finally now with the Lord, and boy, that makes us all happy. I thank the Lord.
Yes. Thank you, Layla. Let us pray. Lord, we joyfully thank you and praise you for all the wonderful blessings you bestow upon us. Those, the blessings of friends and family, of home and relationship. We thank you humbly and deeply the way you have surrounded us with love. Lord, we lift up all those who are struggling right now, whether they are struggling with issues of employment and finance, or whether those near and dear, those who are struggling with health care, Lord, that you be with them and you be with all those who attend to them, that you give them wisdom and compassion as they deal with these, your sons and daughters. We also lift up those who have departed, Lord, that those who have touched our heart, those who have called us into a deeper relationship with one another as well as with you. We thank you for their import in our lives. We thank you for the way that they have touched us in their lives. We thank you for allowing us to know them. Lord, there is much hurt and pain in this world. And sometimes it just seems such a hard thing. How do we deal with all this? But we are so thankful that you're bigger and greater than all of this. And in the end, you lift each person's spirit and dry each eye and caress each one in love. We pray all this, trusting and hoping in the promise of your Son and the resurrection. We pray all this in the name of Jesus, and let the people say, amen. Amen. Thank you, Layla.
The peace of Christ be with you always.
And also with you. Let us pass that peace, but also remember to get over to those sanitation stations, because there's a lot of nasty stuff going around. And I really don't want to see anybody get it.
Peace, everybody. Peace. 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 Peace.
Let us pray together the offering prayer as one voice. Blessed are you, Holy One, for all good things come from you. Bread and cup, open heaven to us. Meet us at the table, that receive what we seek and follow your Son, Jesus, in whose name we pray. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior, Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death in the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so, with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Some 2,000 years ago, in a place that wasn't the center of the empire, in a tradition that wasn't widely practiced by the people of the world, an event took place that wasn't recorded in the history books, but it was still one of the most important events that ever took place. See, our Lord Jesus came out of the wilderness, came out of the backwoods, and came into the center of where his people would gather, and he gathered around his followers. And at the beginning of the meal, he took a loaf of bread and he held it up and he blessed it and then he broke it. And he said, this is my body and it's being given to you for the forgiveness of sin. Do this whenever you do it in remembrance of me. In that same manner, after supper, he took the cup. And then he also blessed it. And he said, in this cup is my blood. And it's going to be poured out for the forgiveness of sin. And not just for you, but for all people, for all time. So I want you to do this whenever you do this. And remember me.
Amen.
And now, let us say those words that we have been taught by our Savior. And let's say them boldly. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. All are invited to this table. When you are indicated, you can take this communion in three ways. You can come forward when you're indicated by the usher. You'll be handed a piece of bread, which you can then intinct or dip into either cup. The cup with the dark liquid is wine. The cup with the lighter liquid is grape juice. Either is fine. You can also, if you're still nervous about germs, because not just COVID, but the flu and strep throat and RVA or something, there's all sorts of things going around, and I understand sanitation. And if you're nervous about it, we have pre-packed sanitary elements in the back that rather than coming forward, you can go back and receive those. If you're not able to come forward but want to receive from the bread and the cup, stay seated. Before we finish, I will ask, is anybody else like to be served? Just raise your hand and I will come to you, because God always comes first to us. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Please be seated.
We are the bread of salvation.
let us pray that prayer after communion as one voice. Giver of every gift, Christ's body is my food. We are Christ's body. Raise us to life by your power for the benefit for all and for your glory, now and forever. Amen. And now, go out, discover who you are and whose you are, and then choose to purposely serve the Lord in each and everything that you do. And go out now in the name of the Father and of the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Go in peace, you are God's beloved.